Good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure. My name is Bill Sprigg. I was one of the co-conveners for this session, recognizing that an awful lot of work has been going on now in airborne dust related work, dust modeling observations, and the implications of windblown dust. So we thought it would be a good time for us to take stock of maybe where we are in much of this, have a session that begins to assemble a lot of the people that are now working independently and quite separated around the world, trying to understand these airborne dust phenomena. And so today, we're very happy to have a number of excellent talks. Those of you who have seen the posters, I think, will agree with me that we're now entering a brand new era of being able to coordinate and collaborate on this work. So this afternoon, we're going to hear a number of oral presentations, sort of covering the map, if you will. And my co-conveners here, Bruce Moskovich and Hisham El-Askari, will introduce the following speakers. I'm going to be talking a little bit later, so I don't want to take part in that. I'm going to take my seat, just like you, and listen to what everyone else is saying. Thank you very much.
Our first talk today will be given by Rich Reynolds. It's an invited talk, and the title is On Iron Oxide Minerals in Atmospheric Dust and Soil Sediment Studies of Types and Properties to Assess Environmental Effects.
Okay. Thanks. Well, it was a very, very bad idea to be standing in this place in the face of this onrushing wall of dust. And we can be impressed by the massiveness of this dust cloud, and also perhaps by its red color, which is caused by a certain class of iron oxide minerals, the ferric oxide minerals, in which the iron is all in the oxidized state. And so here's a satellite image of a huge dust front sweeping eastward across Australia in an event in September of 2009, an event known as Red Dawn that actually affected the majority of Australians. And we can see in this dust cloud those reddish tints that are characteristic of the ferric oxide minerals. And we know that dust particles can reflect, scatter, absorb solar radiation, and it turns out that the ferric oxide minerals have a huge capacity to absorb solar radiation, and therefore they have a strong influence in the effects of dust on atmospheric temperatures and dynamics. And the same dust front went out over the Tasman Sea, and some of the dust was deposited in the snow cover of New Zealand, where it accelerated the melting of the snow cover when it was exposed to springtime sunlight, and a lot of the dust, as you can imagine, was deposited into the Tasman Sea. Now, we know that certain iron compounds and iron oxides are soluble in seawater, and in doing so, they release their iron, which is an essential nutrient for the fertilization of phytoplankton, and with a consequent drawdown of atmospheric CO2. Oh, now, this is why it was called Red Dawn, as you can see. And images like this evoke concern about the effects of dust on human health, and we'll return to this topic at the end of the talk. So atmospheric dust and the iron in it affect the Earth system in a number of different important ways. It affects climate, melting of snow and ice, marine productivity, and human health. And we could better understand these effects if we could better understand the ferric oxide minerals in dust, their types, their abundances, and their particle sizes. And it's even important to distinguish among the different ferric oxide minerals, especially between the two most common kinds, hematite and goethite, and that's a subject of this talk. The overall aim of this talk is to point us in the direction of better understanding the iron oxide minerals, the ferric oxide minerals especially, in dust, so that we could better understand the effects of dust on our environment. We can look at these satellite images of some major dust sources around the globe, and we can tell by their colors. We get some clues about the ferric oxide minerals in the dust on the basis of the colors, these reds and oranges here and here coming out of North Africa, probably indicating something about the presence of hematite, the particle sizes, and perhaps the concentrations, and the yellowish dust that's characteristic of Central Asian dust sources, perhaps indicating the dominant presence of goethite. But we don't have to go so far away to study dust and the iron oxide minerals in it. So I'm going to talk about two primary or major North American dust sources this afternoon. One of these is in the southern Colorado Plateau dust source region. And here we see in that region, in the area of the Little Colorado River Basin, dust not coming from the riverbed itself, but coming from different geomorphic settings in this very low, dry, windy basin. Hundreds of individual plumes of dust, many with different shades of reds, orange, pinks, and even purples in here. Well, this dust commonly blows in late winter, early spring, and the dust goes in a northeasterly direction, as seen in this geostationary satellite image, to land in snow cover on Colorado mountains. And this is the snowpack that's the primary source for water for the entire Colorado River basin through here, and it's nearly 30 million thirsty inhabitants. The other dust source is in this area called the Milford Flat dust source area. It sends dust similarly in late spring, early winter, especially active in the springs of 2008, 2009, northeasterly into the heavily populated Wasatch Front, where Salt Lake City is located, and beyond that into the Wasatch and Uinta Mountains. Also active during some of those dust storms, we saw dust coming from the salt-crusted severe dry lake, a salt-crusted playa here. We can actually associate or attribute the deterioration of air quality in the Wasatch Front to the arrival of far-traveled dust, especially from the Milford Flats area during the springs of 2008, 2009. So this is a plot of PM10 particulate matter, less than 10 microns in aerodynamic diameter, plotted against time, and we see, again, increases in PM10, deterioration of air quality with the arrival of the far-traveled dust seen in GOES images. Well, as I mentioned, the dust lands on snow cover and forms these layers of dust within the snow cover of the Colorado Mountains. And work by Tom Painter and his colleagues have shown that these dust layers in this snow cover decreases the albedo of the snow surfaces, it triggers earlier and faster snow melt, and it leads to overall lower water supplies, partly because of increased or enhanced evapotranspiration related to from these mountain landscapes related to the early loss of the snow cover. And so we're going to examine the iron oxide minerals, especially the ferric oxide minerals, in dust samples and dust source samples using a combination of techniques: reflectance spectroscopy, by which we can determine the radiative properties of the dust and the dust source sediments, and also can use it to identify iron oxide minerals. And the other technique uses the methods of mineral magnetism complemented by Mossbauer spectroscopy to identify the magnetic iron oxide minerals. So our technique for reflectance spectroscopy uses a bidirectional method with a fixed halogen light source and a fiber optic pickup at a constant height above a sample. And in this way, we can generate these reflectance spectra from 0.3 to 3 microns, here shown for two of our 11 ferric oxide standards, goethite on the top spectrum and nanohematite on the bottom spectrum. We can see here at low wavelengths the extraordinary absorption of solar radiation by these two minerals. And here are some examples of reflectance spectra for a couple of dust source sediments up here and dust on snow samples down here. And in some of the following slides, I'll summarize some of these results. using two fairly simple parameters. The first is the average reflectance over the total spectrum, represented by this dashed line, and the other is the average reflectance over just the visible portion of the solar radiation spectrum, shown by that line there. For magnetic properties, we can use the methods of mineral magnetism, rock magnetism, to distinguish between the two main classes of magnetic minerals, the strongly magnetic minerals exemplified by magnetite, and the weakly magnetic minerals, the ferric oxide minerals, the most common of which are hematite and goethite. Now, these minerals have very different intrinsic magnetic properties. Magnetite is very strongly magnetic, but it's easy to fully magnetize at low fields that we easily reach in the laboratory, whereas these ferric oxide minerals, although they're weak, they obtain magnetization, they acquire magnetization in laboratory fields above which magnetite is fully magnetized. So this is an important difference, and we can exploit this difference by obtaining a parameter called HIRM, or hard isothermal remnant magnetization. This is our measure, mostly in this talk, for the concentration or the amounts of ferric oxide minerals, hematite and goethite, when they're both present. HIRM is represented by this blue bar here, and it's the difference in magnetization when we take a sample, apply a relatively strong field to that sample. Here we've completely magnetized magnetite, and some of the ferric oxide has also acquired a magnetization. Turn the sample around and give it a magnetization in the opposite direction in a field that just completely magnetizes magnetite. There's a difference in these two magnetizations, and that difference is attributed to the amount of ferric oxide mineral. So in this way, we actually can get a measure of ferric oxide mineral, even though it's very weakly magnetic. And so here's a plot of ferric oxide amount against, this is HIRM, against average reflectance for a number of samples from the Little Colorado River dust corridor. And here, these were sieved to less than 20 microns. And here we see the higher the amount of ferric oxide, the lower the reflectance. And this is just what we were hoping to see, is that the extra or the large amounts of ferric oxide had an effect on the absorption of solar radiation in this sample suite. And the next slide is a little bit more complicated. Here we see the same samples in this reddish-brown color. Here they're sieved to less than 63 microns to correspond with the particle sizes in these other samples. But overall, for this sample group, we see the higher amounts of ferric oxide correspond to lower average reflectance. There's more absorption of solar radiation with more or greater amounts of the ferric oxide. These gray symbols here represent dust from the Milford Flat. These are dust source sediments from the Milford Flat, sieved to less than 63 microns. Yellow diamonds come from several settings, sandy settings in the Kalahari Desert, sieved to less than 45 microns. And these two samples, oh, and this sample down here comes from a salt-crusted playa, Sevier Lake playa. And these samples here come from an off-road vehicle area near Las Vegas. And this dust, by the way, is high in arsenic. Here's a plot of iron oxide amount, HIRM, against average reflectance over the visible part of the spectrum. And these are all associated with the Milford Flats and related dust downwind in the Wasatch Mountains in snow cover. So the bright green dots are actually from dust source sediments in the Milford Flats area. These darker green dots come from salt crusts and salt dust at Sevier Lake Playa. And again, we can see the general trend. The higher the amount of ferric oxide, the lower the reflectance. The yellow boxes here represent dust from snow cover in the Wasatch Mountains collected by Tom Painter and his colleagues. They show, they appear here in a mid-range of ferric oxide content, but one of these samples seems to be actually a fairly good match with evaporite mineral or salt dust from a playa. The sample markers with the dots in the middle contain goethite as the dominant ferric oxide mineral. And this is based on best fit matching of the reflectance spectra to those 11 standards. And the best fit actually comes out to one particular goethite standard. And so in this way, we can say, and we don't see any hematite as a dominant ferric oxide in any of these samples, only goethite. Now, the situation is more complicated for the southern Colorado Plateau dust sources. We can break this dust source region into three subregions. Over here is the Little Colorado River dust source dust corridor. Here, all the dust source sediments that we've worked with so far have been derived from the weathering of lower Mesozoic red sedimentary rocks, old red sedimentary rocks, red beds. The dust source sediments over here in the Chuska Valley are grayish. They're not red, they're gray, and they've been derived almost entirely from Cretaceous sedimentary rocks. And it's a mixed situation in the intervening Shinley Valley here. Some of the dust source sediments are derived from the red beds, some from the Cretaceous sediments. And we can even see in some locales mixing of these two types of sediments in one place prior to dust emission. So we're going to summarize the ferric oxide mineralogy for these three subregions in the southern Colorado Plateau in the following way. All the samples we've looked at so far from this subregion show nanohematite as the dominant ferric oxide mineral. And this, again, is based on best fit matching of reflectance spectra to the standards we have. So nanohematite is the dominant ferric oxide mineral here. All the samples from the Chuska Valley here show goethite as the dominant ferric oxide mineral. And it's a mixed bag for those samples in the Chinle Valley here. We've examined in this way 23 samples so far, 23 separate layers of dust collected from snow cover in the Colorado Mountains. And of those, about 60% show nanohematite as the dominant ferric oxide mineral. And of course, the others show dominant goethite as the ferric oxide minerals. All of this by way of showing that this technique can tell us something then about the ferric oxide mineralogy. Well, this result from the southern Colorado Plateau is not surprising because we see during big windstorms and big dust emission across this region, all three areas are active simultaneously. So there's nanohematite and goethite being blown up into snow cover at the same time. And we also see evidence for strong atmospheric mixing from these dust sources en route to the Colorado Mountains. Now, we learn even more when we look at the examine the magnetic iron oxide minerals. And this can be done with a huge amount of specificity using the techniques of mineral magnetism and Mossbauer spectroscopy. That is, these tell us a lot more about the magnetic iron oxides. And here we really are getting at the kinds of answers and information that we are really after. So here are two Mossbauer spectra for a sample from dust on snow cover from the San Juan Mountains of Colorado. The upper one is at room temperature, the lower one 4.2 Kelvin. In this low temperature run, we see hematite and goethite. 41% of the iron in this sample is held in hematite. 15% of the iron in this sample is held in goethite. Now, another interesting, and this is great to know, but it gets, I think, more interesting, in that goethite is not seen in the room temperature run. That means that goethite is not magnetic at room temperature. And based on decades of work at the Institute for Rock Magnetism, University of Minnesota, where this work is now being done in our collaboration, based on decades of work there, we know then that the goethite in this sample is nanophase. It's nanogoethite, less than about 20 nanometers in size. And pointing out that this is work by Bruce Moskowitz and colleagues at Institute for Rock Magnetism on the samples that I've discussed already. Hematite is present in both of these, but it's very unusual to see magnetic hematite at such low temperatures. And that tells us something important about its grain size. It must be at least microcrystalline, less than on the order of 100 nanometers in size. So just using Mossbauer spectroscopy, we get information about the partitioning of iron in these different minerals and a lot of information about their particle sizes. There are many different kinds of magnetic property measurements that are being made on these samples. This just shows one example. This is low temperature demagnetization of that sample, just shown for Mossbauer spectroscopy. And what's interesting in this plot is something that's missing. What's missing is evidence for a magnetic transition at 260K that is seen for well-crystallized hematite. So the hematite in this sample is not well-crystallized. It's not your bulk, big hematite. It's very small. So taken all together, the reflectance spectroscopy, Mossbauer spectroscopy, and these magnetic property measurements indicate that the hematite particle sizes are very, very small, microcrystalline, perhaps some nanophase hematite, certainly less than 100 nanometers in size. And we can actually see this hematite. Here's a high-resolution scan electron photomicrograph showing with an iron map here indicated by the red dots, showing the presence of a very thin coating or film of likely hematite on a quartz grain. Here's a scale bar of 10 microns. This coating is on the order of a few tens of nanometers thick. So our immediate goals are to quantify hematite, goethite fractions in dust. A lot of these magnetic methods are actually pointing the way to fingerprinting the dust using magnetic property measurements. We want to quantify magnetic fractions in dust because magnetite is probably a proxy for igneous rock fragments. In most of our cases, this is basalt, and the basalt is very dark, so this might be an absorber of solar radiation. We'll also be looking at organic matter types, abundances, and origins. So the ultimate goals are to improve radiative transfer models for snowmelt and atmospheric dynamics with this kind of information and improve our understanding of the effects of dust on human health. And that brings us back to Red Dawn. There's concern about the role of iron and other metals in dust on the generation of reactive oxygen species that leads to lung inflammation. And there's concern about the roles of iron as a stimulant for pathogens in lung disease. And so I foresee in the future, actually happening now, a big opportunity for the dust community to collaborate and work with the medical community to examine these effects with our real samples and the samples that from actual dust source sediments and dust that are well characterized. This has not been done before. This might seem surprising, but EPA has not looked at effects of dust on lungs using real dust. And so we're embarking on this right now, examining the interactions among dust particles, iron metabolism, and oxidants. So particles in lung tissue actually disrupt iron metabolism, iron homeostasis, and accumulate iron that leads to oxidative stress and down this pathway towards lung inflammation and disease. And so now we're working with the particle pulmonology group at EPA, sharing our samples of dust and well-characterized standards so that we'll be exposing human lung tissue to these dust samples and well-characterized standards to look at this pathway leading towards lung inflammation and potentially disease. Thanks very much.
I think we need to move ahead to the next talk, which is 13BO2, mineral aerosol sizes and their implications for climate and biogeochemistry. It's an invited talk, and the speaker will be Natalie Mohawad. You're not Natalie, are you?
Well, I can tell you the speaker is not Natalie Mohawad because he couldn't make it, so I'm giving her talk, or our talk. This is the laser. Great. Okay, so my name is Jasper Kok, and I'm going to be talking about the size distribution of mineral dust aerosols and implications for climate. Now, just to take a step back, aerosol effects on climate, there's many. I'm just going to discuss real brief the first three and how they depend on the size distribution. So the most important effects are probably radiation effects, direct effects, interactions with clouds, the indirect effect, and then what has more recently been realized and or studied more heavily and what Rich also discussed, effects on biogeochemistry, for instance, from deposition and stimulation of ecosystem productivity. Now, the point here is that all these effects depend quite sensitively on the size distribution of the dust, and they all do in a different way. For instance, the direct effect with radiation scales with the dust surface area. And in particular, small dust, what we call clay, smaller than 2 microns, tends to cool because it's on the order of the wavelength of natural light. And you can see that quite clearly in this graph. This is based on results of Miller et al. 2006, so global circulation model study. This is the globally averaged negative top of atmosphere radiative effect per teragram of atmospheric load. So you can see the smaller the particle, in general, the larger the punch, because you have more surface area per volume. And larger dust tends to not only scatter, but also absorb shortwave and interact with longwave radiation. This results in warming interactions, meaning that on a global scale, very coarse dust probably tends to warm, but that's located mainly close to source regions. So that you can see in this plot that goes with their right axis, so positive top of atmosphere radiative forcing. So the critical point from this graph is that depending on the size of the dust, you get cooling or warming. So pretty important to figure out what the size of dust is, the size distribution. Now, whereas radiative effects scale with the surface area, cloud interactions depend on the ability of dust to serve as a nucleus for condensation. So that depends on the number density of dust. And in particular, fine dust upwards of about 0.1 micron is probably important as a cloud condensation nuclei. There was a real nice paper on this by Cynthia Tui 2 years ago. Because dust tends to be relatively coarse aerosol, it's very important as an ice nuclei, upwards of around half a micron per, upwards of about half a micron in size. So direct effects scale with surface area, indirect with number. Effects on biogeochemistry scale with volume, because it's the volume, obviously, that delivers the nutrients to ecosystems. We did some simulations of this with Akinori Ito. These are basically his results. Simulations of the dust deposition flux in terms of grams per square meter per year. And this, again, indicates the importance of the size distribution. The top is assuming a size distribution at emission as measured by Dalmeida, 1987, and used, for example, in Charlie Zender's 2003 paper. The bottom is with the theoretical size distribution that I'll talk about in a minute, which contains more coarse dust and less fine dust. And the point here is that both simulations are tuned to the same global aerosol optical depth for dust, and you get a lot more deposition when you have more large particles, like in the theoretical size distribution. That's easier to see with the ratio. So this is the ratio of the deposition flux with the theoretical and the Dalmeida size distribution. You can see there's a strong enhancement of dust deposition, obviously close to source regions, which is where we probably care about at least, but also further out to oceanic regions where it's important, like Rich mentioned, for productivity of ecosystems there. Okay, so that was in way of introduction about what the how the effects on climate of dust depend on the size of the dust. And I'm going to take you on basically a tour through what we know about the size distribution of dust from the beginning, from the emission at the source, through measurements we have near source regions, to measurements we have when the size the dust is deposited. So first, at the source, this is not as easy a measurement to make as you might think. So what this involves, what we're after is the size distribution of dust as it is being emitted. So for that, it's not enough to just measure the concentration of different particle sizes. You need to measure the flux being emitted by the surface. So for that, you need measurements at two heights close to the surface, in an active dust storm that's actively eroding the soil, and then from, if you know the wind speeds at those heights, you can calculate what the source is emitting. We have currently seven data sets of this, of the size distribution of emitted dust. I'm going to plot them on this graph. This is the normalized volume size distribution, normalized meaning integral gives one, volume of aerosol per logarithmically spaced bin versus the aerosol diameter. These are the seven data sets. And one was recently added by Yaping Xiao et al. This year. The first thing we notice from this is that these measurements are relatively uniform. We would, I think, before looking at these data, would have expected a lot of variation between different data sets. But within the experimental uncertainty, a lot of this data falls on top of each other. One of the reasons for this is that the size distribution of dust at emission does actually not depend on the wind speed at emission, contrary to previous assumptions in the literature. And I had a poster on that this morning and published a paper on that recently. Measurements don't show any dependence, and there's also no theoretical reason why there would be a dependence, because the impacts of bouncing sand particles that emits the dust actually does not depend on the wind speed. It does not increase with the wind speed, contrary to what has been assumed. In addition, it appears that there's a limited dependence of the size distribution of dust on the soil size distribution, meaning that there's about 7 different data sets here. Let's see. Oh, there we go. 7 different data sets, all for different soils, but the scatter in the measurements is limited. So that leads me to hypothesize that there's not a lot of variation with different source regions. But of course, we need a lot more measurements to really look into this hypothesis more carefully. So in addition to understanding from the uniformity of measurements, having a handle on the size distribution of this dust, was a recent paper I published earlier this year using an analogy of dust emission with fragmentation of brittle materials like glass. And based on that, we found this theoretical relation that meshes these measurements very well, and thus much better than empirical relations that in general have too much fine dust. You can see that here. So these three, the red, blue, and green line, all have too much fine dust. And this is probably because many of these empirical relations are based on measurements of dust in the atmosphere, where a lot of the coarse dust might have already fallen out. So based on the uniformity of measurements and theory that describes them pretty well, we seem to have a handle on the size distribution at the source, with an important caveat here that we know that different measurement techniques can produce different size distributions, and that could be affecting these measurements. So we need definitely more investigation into that. Okay, so with having at least a reasonable theory to describe the size distribution of dust, we put this into the global model Chem4 and use it to predict single scattering albedos of aerosols. You can see that that's the top graph here. So it's the model simulation where the redder the color, the higher the single scattering albedo, meaning more scattering and less absorption. The bottom here is what's measured with the ground-based sound photometer network called AeroNet. And I'm going to focus here on where we know the signal is dominated by dust. So that is near North Africa. So when we plot what's modeled versus what's observed, we get this. Vertical is what's modeled. Horizontal is what's observed. And this is modeled with the size distribution that was used by Mahoa et al. 2006, which has too much fine dust compared to observations, although not quite as much as some of the other empirical relations I showed. But if we instead use the theoretical relation, which has more large dust, less fine dust, this brings it in better agreement. The reason being that when you have more large, this means more absorption, more interactions, more absorption of shortwave, and thus lowering the single scattering albedo. The flatness you see of the model results, so the model results are pretty much the same value, whereas the AeroNet measurements vary more. This flatness might be due to a lack of mineralogy in the dust emission scheme, pretty much what Rich was talking about. They were missing all this variation in iron oxide. And we're currently working on this, graduate student in our group. An alternative hypothesis here is that the overestimate of the single scattering albedo as well as the flatness could be due to an underestimate of biomass burning, just for completion. Okay, so we have these measurements of dust size distribution at the source. We know, or at least we saw, that they're pretty uniform, that the theory describes them pretty well. Now let's move further away from the source. So let's take the next step after emission and look at in situ measurements of dust size distributions near the source. So for that, you need a model. So we used WARFCAM, a regional model, and I used specifically the WARFCAM dust module by Zhao et al., published last year in Atmospheric Chemistry and Physics. So what I'm going to do is compare modeled size distributions of dust using different assumptions or different starting emission size distributions and compare them against in situ measurements. I'm going to start with measurements made during the AMA field campaign, the African Monsoon Multidisciplinary Analysis in Niger, where this axis in 2006. I think these are some of the most accurate measurements because what they did was they flew an airplane through a dust storm and then collected dust on a filter and then took the filter back to the lab and used electron microscopy to very accurately determine the size of the dust. When they did that, they got this, the yellow circles here, vertical again being size distribution, volume of aerosol per logarithmically spaced bin versus aerosol diameter. When we simulate the size distribution for the same point in time and space with the theoretical size distribution, we get this, the black line, again in pretty good agreement. When we use those empirical size distributions I showed you earlier, we get these colored lines. So we get the same idea here, that the empirical size distribution seems to overestimate the amount of small dust particles here, submicron dust. Okay, so I just said that. And this is similar for other in situ measurements we've looked at. This is the same field campaign. This is a different measurement. This is an optical particle counter mounted on a wing. And again, you can see that black line follows the measurements more closely than the colored lines. Same for the Dodo field campaign, also in 2006. And since 2006 was such a really big year for field measurements, also the Samam field campaign in Morocco, 2006, you can see the same trend here, that the black line follows the measurements pretty closely and the colored lines overestimate the fine fraction. Okay, so I showed you we seem to have a handle on the size distribution at the source. We seem to do okay plugging this understanding into models and reproducing measurements of the size distribution near the source. Now let's talk about a more difficult problem, and that is trying to reproduce the size distribution at deposition. This is more difficult because there are several interactions occurring during transport that complicate this, that we do not understand that well. First of all, interactions with chemical species. For example, coating of dust occurs by nitrate and sulfate that affects the size distribution and subsequent interactions, such as with other aerosols, can lead to internal mixing. And cloud processing. Many dust aerosols are aggregates. And so if they act as cloud nuclei, they become dissolved in water, which can affect their aggregation state. They can become partially disaggregated. Moreover, if you have a cloud droplet that is collecting many different dust aerosols and then the cloud droplet evaporates, the question is what happens to the dust? Does it all stick together, for instance? Does it all become cemented? Those are all questions we need to include in models and, first of all, of course, understand. And these are just some of the issues. There's obviously more. And in general, we do not understand them that well. Moreover, when the dust is being deposited and then taken to the lab to be for the size distribution to be analyzed, there are several interactions that affect the size distribution. I'm doing something wrong here, it looks like. There we go. If it's deposited to land, you can get compaction of the sediment, weathering, erosion. All this affects can affect the size distribution of dust. If it's deposited to water, you get the same interactions or similar as in clouds. Compaction of the sediment, partial disaggregation in the water. There's a nice paper on this by Mason et al. And Katina earlier this year. Then when it's taken from the sediment core and brought through a lab environment, often the measurement, for example, through a Kolder counter, occurs by suspension in an electrolyte or in water. Sometimes the sample is even exposed to sonification or adding of a dispersion. Now, all these processes obviously affect the aggregation state of the dust, meaning that this could create a difference between what is measured in a lab setting and what is simulated as the deposition size distribution. Now, with that in mind, let's compare what we predict with our Chem4 global model of a measure of the size distribution, the defined to total ratio, so PM2.5 to PM over 2. PM2.5 over PM10 at deposition. So the top here. Again, this was modeled. The blue colors here are very small ratio, so meaning very relatively little PM2.5. The red colors meaning much larger fine fraction. And the bottom, the middle graph here, these are measurements from ice cores. So these are the Himalayan measurements, Himalayan ice cores, and Antarctica and Greenland. And then following the lab procedure I just discussed. So if we plot what we model versus what we observe from these ice cores, the vertical here is what's modeled, the fine fraction, versus observed on the horizontal. We can notice two things. One, close to source regions, we tend to overestimate the fine fraction. This could be because a global model is obviously by necessity somewhat crude, and we can have unresolved local sources which would make this deposition flux more coarse than we are modeling it. Far from source regions, long-range transported, we have the opposite problem, where we underestimate the PM2.5 fraction, the fine fraction. So this could be due to all those interactions I discussed, disaggregation during transport, for instance, and/or measurements. Another explanation could be errors in the partitioning between dry deposition and wet deposition. We know that dry deposition tends to deposit the coarse particles and wet deposition much more fine particles. So I think this is one of the frontiers, trying to figure out all these interactions in the atmosphere, which obviously is a much more complicated problem than figuring out what it is at emission. Okay, that brings me to conclusions. So I've shown you, but you probably already know, that the dust impacts on climate are highly sensitive to the size of the dust, and that it affects everything from the radiative effect to deposition to cloud interactions. We seem to have a handle on the size distribution at emission, both from the measurements being relatively uniform and from a new theory that seems to describe them pretty well. Using that, we can capture the size distribution near source regions, although we're looking into this in more detail. That's still a work in progress. However, uncertainties during transport, deposition, and measurement of the size distribution at deposition lead to, I think, quite substantial uncertainties. And that makes it more difficult to simulate the size distribution at deposition. So I think that's one of the frontiers. And we're obviously performing further work to address this. Okay, thank you for your attention. I look forward to questions.
We have time for questions.
Need to be what, sorry?
In snow or ice cores?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I did not mention that. You're right. Yeah, those are all ice cores. Right.
So you don't have any precipitation in wet precipitation?
No.
In more reasonable environment, not reasonable, but you're looking at African dust and things like that, you don't have anything in rainwater.
That's right. I think, so that's not my work. That's by Samuel Albani. Yeah, and so I think he's developing, he's using sediment cores, like marine and lake sediment cores, and getting the size distribution for that. But it's not advanced enough to show here. Please. Oh, so, how do I go back? Let's see, this one, yeah. Okay, so this does not show quantity. This shows just the fine fraction, right? So the red color here does not mean a lot of dust. It means that the dust that does get there is relatively fine, which makes sense because it's long range transported. Well, some of it does make it out there, and that's what's being measured. Is there a question in the back?
Looks like another question.
Yep.
Sugar.
Yeah, that's right. I didn't discuss that. That's right. As I understand the question correctly, he's asking about what the methods were for measuring the size distribution. And so are you talking about the source, size distribution at the source, or in situ? Source and in situ. Okay. So at the source, the measurements they used, two of the data sets used an optical particle counter. I think it was of the Grimm type. And there were four data sets by Dil Gillette in the 70s. And what he did was he had a single-stage cascade impactor and brought the dust that was collected on it to a laboratory and used microscopy to determine the size of the dust. And for in situ measurements, there were several techniques. Some of them were electron microscopy, which I think is... Well, I'm not an experimentalist myself, but it seems to me it's most accurate. And then the others were optical particle counters.
Okay, we need to go on to the next talk. Thank you. Next talk is 13B03, The Impact of Climate and Composition on Playa Surface Roughness, and it'll be given by H. Jay Tolerud.
Okay, so today I'm going to talk about the development of surface roughness of a playa in the context of dust emission. So this image is an image of dust emission in a playa. So the dust is important for geochemical cycles, as we've heard. And however, it's relatively difficult to estimate this parameter in the past or the future for a variety of reasons, but for one thing, since dust is very significantly variable in space and time, it's hard to understand precisely what is changing. So for example, in this image, you can see that this playa looks relatively uniform, but there's plumes of dust coming off of it. And so one factor that can control the emission of dust is the erodibility of the surface. So for example, in these two images, these are two images from the playa, and this first image is very strong and very crusted and very difficult to erode, whereas the second image is much more sensitive to disturbance. You can see this footprint here shows that it's relatively easy to disturb. And so this soil erodibility is an important factor, but it's not very well understood. So what we would like to do is to look at this on a larger scale and to try to understand what variables might be controlling surface erodibility on a sort of regional scale. The only easy way to do this over the course of a short amount of time is to look at remote sensing, since field observations are relatively time intensive. And so the way we're going to do that is by looking at the roughness of the surface. So in this case, this strong surface is quite smooth, whereas this rough surface is, or this this more sensitive surface is much rougher. And so we're looking at roughness as a proxy for the strength of the surface. So then our goal is to look at an active dust producer and distinguish smooth surfaces and rough surfaces across this region, and to look at changes in these in the surface roughness over time. And the ultimate goal is to improve our understanding of the erodibility of the surface. So our method for doing this is synthetic aperture radar. And radar is an active process whereby the sensor sends out a signal, and if the surface is smooth relative to the wavelength of the satellite, which in this case is 5.6 centimeters, then the signal is reflected back away from the sensor, whereas on a rough surface, some of the signal gets reflected back toward the satellite. So then in this case, you expect that that relatively rough surfaces will be bright in the radar returns, whereas smooth surfaces will be dark. So in this image over here, this is an oil spill. And so the oil spill areas are dark and smooth, whereas the rest of the surface is relatively bright and rough. And there is one complication in looking at radar data, in the sense that it measures roughness, but it also has a strong impact on, or the surface has a strong impact on the radar returns as well. And in particular, the most important variable is soil moisture. And so soils that are bright can emit strongly as well as rough surfaces. So rough surfaces and moist surfaces tend to be bright. So the study area we're looking at is the Black Rock Desert in northwestern Nevada. It's a large playa northwest of some of the other areas that I think we've been talking about today. It is an active dust producer, and so we can look at these processes that are occurring over the course of this active dust production region. So we have several sources of data. The main one, of course, that we're looking at today is we have 7 years of these ASAR observations, and these are all during the summertime when the soil is relatively dry. We also have Landsat data to compare with it. And then we have two field visits that we can compare our roughness observations to. And then I'm not going to talk about it today, but we also have hyperspectral data from the Black Rock Desert in 2007. And we're looking at that to understand the composition of the surface. So the image here is a Landsat image of the Black Rock Desert. The bright areas are the playa itself, and then the dark areas are the surrounding mountains. So to validate our use of this ASAR data, we looked at a sort of qualitative ground truthing measurement, where we have about 30 sites that we visited during the field observations, and we have GPS coordinates for each of that. So we compare that to the return from the synthetic aperture radar instrument, and in general, this is a pretty, at least on the qualitative level, this is a very good measure. The smooth surfaces have a much lower return than the rough surfaces, and they sort of go from smooth to slightly rougher all the way up to the most rough we have. So here is an image of roughness in the Black Rock Desert. The red areas are on the playa, and they are the synthetic aperture radar data. The background is just the Landsat data to help orient you. So the rough areas are bright, whereas the dark areas are relatively smooth. So this is interesting just off on the face of it, in that we can see that there's a pretty wide variability in the amount of roughness in the playa. So there's some areas that are quite smooth, whereas some of the areas are quite a bit rougher. So then we go from there to look at the variation of the surface roughness over time. And one thing that sort of immediately jumps out looking through these various images over the course of seven summers is that the images tend to be very constant over the course of the summer from June to September, whereas in between different years, they pretty much change completely, and you can barely see the same pattern at all. So in the course of these 3 years, the correlation between the 3 years is only in the 0.2, whereas the correlation between different images from the same year are relatively high. So there's little change during the summer. And this is quite interesting because the Black Rock Desert is a fairly strong source of anthropogenic activity. There's a lot of people out there driving around quite often. And also, there's some dust activity during the summertime, too. So this is showing that all that human activity and the dust emission is not at least changing the large-scale dust or the large-scale surface roughness pattern in the playa itself, and that the processes during the wintertime are much more important for changing the large-scale surface roughness. So then we go from there to look at what the changes might be over the course of a wintertime. So here's an image from 2009 compared to a radar image from 2010. And one thing that jumps out to some extent is that there's this smoother area here in the image from 2010 that doesn't appear on this image from 2009. And then if you look at the Landsat, but this is MODIS data from during the winter time, you see that there's this this Playa Lake here that was present for a couple of weeks and showed up on this MODIS data, and it's almost exactly the same size and shape as this smoother area in 2010. This is not necessarily too surprising, since the water acts to that the water would act to smooth the surface. But it's interesting that it operates on such a large scale. So then we also looked at the distribution of roughness versus precipitation across the playa. So in some areas, comparing different years of observations relative to the annual precipitation of the year before relative to the surface roughness of a region in La Playa, we found that that high precipitation years tend to be relatively smooth. And this is also perhaps not entirely surprising since the rain acts to smooth the surface, but it's an interesting relationship that we can see it through the satellite data. But then the other thing is that in some areas of the playa, we don't see this relationship at all. And that might be an effect of surface moisture. This shouldn't be an effect of surface moisture since the surface moisture should go in the other direction. But it's possible that there's some variation or addition of surface moisture in this in other areas of the playa that are affecting it. But if not, the differences in roughness over the course of the year must be affected by some other process, which is perhaps potential for future work. So in summary, the playa roughness maps changed significantly between different summers, and they didn't go back to a very similar state even under similar climate circumstances, but they had relatively low variability over the course of the summer. So the actions of people on the playa are not at least changing the large-scale surface roughness. And then also heavy annual precipitations tends to smooth at least some areas of the playa, but not necessarily all. And then dry years tend to be relatively rough. And then also we have this a bit of data that's showing that perhaps there's more evaporite precipitation associated with these smoother surface roughness areas, which might be helping to strengthen the surface. Oh, all right. Acknowledgements. And thanks for the talk.
Thank you. We have time for more questions.
Yeah, no, this is supposed to be it is certainly true that high surface roughness areas might inhibit dust production, and low surface roughness areas might be sources of dust production. I don't think I was clear enough about that. We're looking at the development of surface roughness in the hopes that in some cases it's associated with these really strong solid crusts in this playa in particular, where we went out and observed that a lot of these strong solid crusts are present and they're very smooth. But it certainly is possible that there could be areas that are smooth and not particular and strong dust sources too, and that's a good avenue for future research to look at the sources of plumes and compare it to the surface roughness. So the answer to the first half of the question is that it's that they're 30 meter pixel sizes. And what was the
second one would be, did you look at any of those relationships with annual precipitation or changes from year to year or month to month in roughness, with your roughness aggregated at say a larger window size larger than 30 meters?
That was aggregated beyond the 30 meter pixel size because there was enough noise in the 30 meter pixel size that it was a little bit difficult. So it was, so it's over approximately the area of those boxes that these relationships are. And then we also looked at the relationships on the individual pixel size, and there's some more noise in the data, but but it tends to be that there's relationships, especially along the edges of the playa.
Okay, thank you. Okay, our next presentation is 13B04, clays and mineral dust aerosols, and the speaker will be J.C.D. Hatch.
Good afternoon. All right, so today I'm going to talk to you about the research program that I've developed at Hendricks College, which involves integrating multidisciplinary research experiences for undergraduate students surrounding the impacts of clay minerals as mineral dust aerosol in the atmosphere. The work that I'm going to be presenting was done exclusively by undergraduate students and was funded by the National Science Foundation, the Research Corporation for Science Advancement, and the Hendricks College Odyssey Program. I'm going to begin with a brief introduction to Hendricks College, mainly because some of its core values directly relate to the goals and approach with which I've developed my research program. I'll then talk about some implications and the significance of mineral dust aerosol in the atmosphere, and particularly our interest in clay minerals as a dominant component of mineral dust aerosol. And then I'm also going to introduce some of the ongoing research projects in my lab and some results or initial results at trying to integrate those multidisciplinary research projects. And finally, I'll discuss some future directions of those projects and give some motivation for transdisciplinary discourse in trying to understand the effects of dust in the atmosphere. Hendricks College is a rapidly growing undergraduate private liberal arts college located in Conway, Arkansas. We have about 1,300 students. At Hendricks, we're in the business of training professionals for today's world. And our motto, which is shown in ancient Greek in our seal, means unto the whole person. With this in mind, what we try to do is to prepare our students for an ever-increasing transdisciplinary contemporary world, whereby we try to teach our students to synthesize knowledge and make connections between multiple disciplines, in hopes that we can encourage them to do collaborative approaches towards furthering our understanding of big complex issues in today's world. All of the research in my lab tries to understand the effects of mineral dust aerosol in the atmosphere. I tried to develop my research program so that each individual student has their own project and that they all have a same common goal. And that common goal is to understand the effects of clay specifically in the atmosphere. The approach of a common goal with individualized experiences helps promote scholarly discourse among the students. It also helps develop critical holistic thinking skills and a feeling of community and collaboration towards a common goal. We also expect ownership and responsibility towards forward progress in the research program. The perceived learning outcomes of this program are that students will learn to step outside of their own disciplines and to make connections between disciplines in order to become lifelong learners as they gain skills in synthesizing and analyzing information through multiple lenses in order to solve complex problems in the contemporary world. So the focus of my research program has been on the study of mineral dust aerosol, and we've already seen some of the implications of dust in the atmosphere, but I want to briefly talk about why my program is focused on dust. Mainly because mineral dust is the largest component of atmospheric aerosol. It makes up almost half of the total aerosol load in the atmosphere, and dust particles can be transported over fairly long distances and have fairly long atmospheric lifetimes. While the dust particles are in the atmosphere, they obviously have implications for climate, whereby they can interfere with the radiative effects in the atmosphere by scattering and absorbing radiation or by serving as cloud and ice nuclei, which we've already seen mentioned today. But also, dust particles can be deposited into the world's oceans and provide nutrients for to stimulate phytoplankton growth. And this is important for climate and biogeochemistry because photosynthetic species are important for large sinks for atmospheric carbon dioxide. What complicates these implications a little more, or our understanding of these implications, is the fact that the long atmospheric lifetimes allows for substantial photochemical and chemical processing of the dust particles while they're in transit through the atmosphere. This can not only change the chemical balance of trace gases in the atmosphere, but it can also change the chemical composition of the dust particles themselves. And any change in the chemical composition of the dust particle can also affect or change the effectiveness of the dust towards their impacts on climate, biogeochemistry, and atmospheric chemical reactivity. These are obviously not exhaustive implications for dust particles, and we've seen some others today, but it does illustrate the need for multidisciplinary approaches in trying to understand these implications in the atmosphere. So all of the experimental work, and this is mainly laboratory work in my lab, looks at clay minerals as the dominant dust component in the atmosphere, mainly because clays make up over half the total atmospheric dust mass, which means they make up about a quarter of the total aerosol mass. And they can be dominantly composed of kaolinite, elite, and montmorillonite clays. We're also interested in clay minerals because of their unique physical and chemical properties, particularly their small particle sizes, the large surface areas, and in some cases, their unique hydration properties. Montmorillonite and elite clays are particularly interesting because they have a relatively high concentration of iron and therefore can have important implications for ocean fertilization. As I mentioned, during transport through the atmosphere, these clay particles can undergo cloud and chemical processing, which can effectively lower the pH of the aerosol particles themselves. This lowering of the pH can influence mineral dissolution and the bioavailability of micronutrients such as iron. So with this in mind, one of the first initial research projects for undergraduate students in my lab was to study the iron dissolution rates of montmorillonite clay under a variety of acidic pH values to simulate the effects of heterogeneous chemical processing on the bioavailability of iron on clays. In order to connect the mineral dissolution studies to the indirect climate effects that occur from ocean fertilization of these from these particles, we're also doing a second research project where we measure phytoplankton growth rates in the presence of clay minerals in both iron-enriched and iron-limited conditions, and this simulates ocean deposition events. Montmorillonite clay is the model clay used in both of these studies, and therefore the students have both a common goal of understanding the effects of ocean deposition and ocean fertilization, as well as having the similar clay, model clay minerals in their studies. And so this promotes scholarly discourse among the students, and it also helps to help them collaborate and evaluate their results in terms of their significance and the meaning of their results, which undergraduates tend to have a difficulty doing. So here are some of the results of the undergraduate students' work. The colorimetric measurements of iron dissolution from the montmorillonite clay showed that at a pH of above 3, iron's not going to be bioavailable, meaning there's no iron dissolution at pHs above 3. However, at a lower pHs, or a pH of about 1, iron dissolution occurs very quickly and reaches completion within about 3 days, at which point about 15% of the total available iron in the clay mineral is considered to be bioavailable or soluble. The graph on the lower left-hand corner shows typical results from our iron dissolution studies from montmorillonite clay at a pH of 1. We also measure phytoplankton growth rates by quantifying the chlorophyll A concentration in phytoplankton cultures as a function of time using the trichromatic method. The graph on the lower right shows results from these initial studies, where you can see that the relative growth rates increase quite significantly, which is indicated by the slope of these graphs, as you add more and more clay to the phytoplankton cultures. So the clay is actually stimulating phytoplankton growth quite significantly. My charge to these students was to get together and actually discuss their results from the independent research projects and come up with integrated conclusions. And what they concluded was that chemical processing of clays in the atmosphere, during transport in the atmosphere, can affect the bioavailable iron from clays. But upon clay deposition to the oceans, you can get significant increases in phytoplankton growth rates or the stimulation of ocean fertilization. However, they also realized quite smartly that at the low pH of the mineral dissolution studies, that's not very representative of what actually happens upon ocean deposition, where the ocean's pH is more basic. And our iron dissolution studies suggested that iron from these clays will not be bioavailable under these ocean pH values. So this kind of begged the question of, well, how do these clays contribute to the enhanced growth rates of the phytoplankton under iron-limited conditions if the iron is not expected to be bioavailable at this pH? So the students got together and they devised a plan, They devised a plan to measure iron dissolution rates from the clays in the iron-limited culture media, both in the absence of phytoplankton and in the presence of phytoplankton. These are very preliminary results, but they did find that the iron does not dissolve in the phytoplankton media when the phytoplankton are not present. However, when the phytoplankton are present, there was some non-zero absorbance from the calorimetric measurements that indicated that some of the iron was dissolved from the clay in these iron-limited environments. Unfortunately, our measurements were just below the detection limits of the calorimetric method. So from these very preliminary studies, the students concluded that the culture media matrix or the ocean stimulated matrix may not be responsible for dissolution of iron and subsequent growth of the phytoplankton. And in fact, it may have more to do with the physiology of the phytoplankton themselves that could be driving iron dissolution and the bioavailability of iron upon ocean deposition. My students are currently trying to repeat these studies using a spectroscopic method that has lower detection limits, so we can actually quantify iron in the phytoplankton media. But the logical next step is to try to address the disciplinary knowledge gap and attempt at understanding how the phytoplankton are affecting the iron dissolution from the clays upon ocean deposition, which is quite interesting. And in doing so, we hope to initiate some multidisciplinary discourse and collaborations and try to develop some transdisciplinary laboratory experiments to help us understand what the phytoplankton are doing or what their contribution to the bioavailability of iron from these clays is. And also, we'd like to try to integrate some of our laboratory results into some theoretical models for comparison to field work. I'd like to acknowledge the undergraduate students who are responsible for developing this program, particularly Meredith Miles, Theogen Bakuti, and Cameron Crane, who were very instrumental in these two projects that I've presented today, and of course, National Science Foundation Research Corporation and Hendricks College Odyssey Program for funding. And I think I have some time for questions. Yeah, we used a standard montmorillonite clay from the Clay Mineral Society. Correct.
Thank you.
Yes, definitely. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, our next speaker is William Sprigg. This is, and he'll be talking on airborne dust models and valley fever research.
Thank you very much. That was a very interesting segue into what I plan to talk about here today, which is how the medical community is responding to some of the advances that we have made as a community in developing simulation and forecasting techniques for dust, airborne dust concentrations, dust storms, and so on. This is a picture of some severe cases of valley fever, which is found endemic in parts of the United States along the border regions, the border states, through Mexico into Central America, South America. And it is a very misunderstood, misdiagnosed kind of affliction. It is caused by the inhalation of spores that live in the soil and hitchhike along with these with the dust particles and the dust storms. So the inhalation of this gets into the lungs first, and in some cases, such as this, it can migrate to other parts of the body. It's quite a serious thing, can result in death. Fortunately for most of us, it's the main response to this is some sneezing and flu-like disturbances, and then you get over it after about 2 or 3 years. But for some, this is a very serious disease. The cause is a soil-dwelling fungi. The fungus responds to weather and climate. If it's moist, it grows. It gets too dry, it gets brittle and falls back into the soil and becomes a mixture with the dust. Inhaling the spores may lead to the infection. I mentioned the flu-like symptoms. The regional mortality and morbidity of this, sometimes there are very serious outbreaks of it, such as in 2004 in Arizona. There were well over 3,000 cases. The United States as a whole, over 6,000, and the deaths reported in this event amounted to 6 to 10% of the reported cases. But now, where is the endemic zone? And this is not very well known, actually, not very high-resolution kind of depiction of where the fungi live, but it's an approximation. And we can see here a couple of different representations of this. It gives you an idea of how little, really, the medical community understands where this spore exists. Here in Mexico, another analysis of the distribution of this spore. In California, the number of valley fever cases, or coccidioidomycosis, or COXI for short, is spread from, say, San Diego pretty much up through the state. Over time, the number of cases varies, and it is a very complex kind of thing, whether it is being diagnosed properly, exposure is an issue, perhaps some of this is due to weather or climatic conditions. This curve is not very well understood, but you can see along the vertical axis, the total number of cases in California varied across the past decade here fairly substantially. In Arizona, the cases have been increasing, apparently, from 1990 through 2009. These are the measurements or the COXIE cases that have been reported per 100,000 population in Arizona over this period of time. Why does that curve appear as it is? My guess is, and the guess of a lot of the medical people associated with this, is that the maybe more and more cases are being correctly diagnosed. They are not being misinterpreted by the symptoms of many other things. We just don't know. So perhaps modeling, perhaps the dust simulation studies that are being done may lend a hand here in interpreting these charts. In Arizona this past year, during this year, we've had a very large number of these storms. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention has taken an interest in this, figuring that the outbreak of storms may give us an opportunity to try to relate airborne dust concentrations, when they occur and where they occur, with the number of cases of valley fever that are being diagnosed. So here was one storm, July 18th, a wall approximately 3,000 feet high, winds 25 to 40 miles per hour, coming into Phoenix, Arizona. It's a pretty intimidating sight. So we are applying Dr. Nitschewitz's model DREAM, the dust regional atmospheric model, with 4 to 8 particle bins appropriately distributing the particle sizes that we see. We are using dust as a proxy for COXIE. We really don't have a good handle on the distribution of the spore, as I mentioned. So we already know that there's a great deal of uncertainty in what we're dealing with. But the model is being run such that it makes 72-hour forecasts of dust concentrations. The horizontal distribution of dust can be determined, surface concentrations, the total column mass or the dust load, wet and dry total deposition, all of the meteorological variables that are associated with dust transport, vertical distribution concentration, cross sections over a fixed point or fixed time profiles. So the versatility of the model in being able to provide a variety of outputs for epidemiological study is a very, very useful tool. Here we can see that the model characterizes the mineral dust being entrained into the atmosphere, any mountain effects, dry deposition, turbulent diffusion. The iron chemistry is being incorporated, wet deposition. Once these particles become part of a cloud or a rain process, it's included in this. And I'll come back to that a little bit later because it helps us understand the connection between the growth of this this fungus and its drying out and its availability to the atmosphere. So all of these characteristics are included in the model. The model is driven by the National Weather Service's ongoing, whatever the current weather forecast models are, that's what we're trying to use, because these models give us the global reach, reputation of the model itself, the continuity. It's maintained by the National Weather Service and its data access, so on. we do not have to worry that much about. The results of some of this work right now is showing us that high resolution, in this case, down to 3.7 kilometers, gives a greater spread of applications for not only health but a variety of other things like safety on the highways. Now, the model domain that is being used right now covers the much of the southwestern part of the United States and parts of Mexico. The outer domain is usually run at a very low resolution, in this case 50-kilometer resolution, inside of which one can locate a smaller domain where you want the higher resolution for the applications that I'm mentioning. In this case, we have used it at about 7.5 kilometers and sometimes now getting down to 3.7 kilometer spatial resolution. The model dust generating component is being driven, as I mentioned, by the National Weather Service models. Variable input data include the initial and boundary conditions of global weather. This can be either the NSEP weather information being ingested by the model or that from ECMWF. The permanent sort of input data that are initializing the model is soil and land cover. And the dust production factors that we've been hearing a little bit about today with some of the previous speakers. The soil structure is important. Soil moisture is very important. We'll see a little example of that in a moment. Vegetation cover. This is what we have been concentrating on over the past decade here with NASA funding from the Earth Sciences applications component in an ability to monitor the vegetation changes that take place not only seasonally, but we find that week by week there are sufficient changes here. So you need a constant refreshing, if you will, of a dust mask where you characterize the exposed dust sources. So I'll give you a couple of examples here of the model runs and simulations of real events. Here was one, the Texas, Oklahoma, on April 15th, 2011. The model dust loading shows a concentration of dust in this region. Both satellite images here are showing you the same kind of characterization. We believe that the model is performing quite well, probably very high spatial correlation in this case. At the same time, there were forest fires or wildfires going on down here. You can see the problem that we have point sources all throughout this region. On July 5th was a storm that, to beat all storms in Phoenix, and this actually stimulated the CDC's interest in what we were doing. I'm going to give a plug here for a paper that you should hear shortly by Anna Vukovic and others. It analyzes this Habub, this big dust storm that occurred on the 5th, she'll show you, I think, some considerable detail from the model experiment. The Valley Fever, we're tracking now Valley Fever in Maricopa County, which includes Phoenix. And we marked here the July 5th Habub. we should be seeing an increase of valley fever cases, but this has been really complicated by a number of other storms. Anna was telling me a little while ago she thinks there are 8 of these storms since July 5th in Arizona. So here we compare it with Maricopa County in 2010 in the blue. We see an increase in the red, but we really don't understand that yet. Here are these the time series of events. We're trying to understand why over this period of time valley fever cases, reported cases, appear as they do. Arizona's peaking up here now more than any time in the recent history. In this, I'm going to show you a sequence of slides that here we have precipitation by its model output, here is soil wetness, and here is the dust. Dust sources primarily from right around in this region, and here we watch as the model generates the dust, changes the soil wetness, and moves precipitation into the region. And if you had time to look at this, as we have, you can see the internal consistency of the model that, internal consistency of the model, where if it's raining, then you get rain out of the particles. There is no dust available in the atmosphere. Or if the soil is too wet, then you're not going to generate any dust here for entrainment in the atmosphere. So we see that this type of modeling can indeed be related, we hope, we'll understand the relationship at any rate, to something like something that's growing in the soil and then being entrained along with the dust in the air. Thank you very much.
To stay on schedule, we can have questions after the next talk during the break if people want to stay around for questions. But the final talk before the break is 13B06, Impacts of Current and Future Dust Deposition on Colorado River Basin Hydrology, given by J.S. Deems.
Mac users always causing trouble. Okay. I'm going to talk to you this afternoon about dust impacts on Colorado River Basin hydrology. Over the past 8 years or so, we and our wide array of collaborators have been studying the impacts and processes and occurrence of dust deposition on snowpacks in the Colorado River Basin. Definitely want to point out that this is really thanks to a lot of work done by a lot of different people. You can see in the image in the background here a shot from about 13,000 feet in the San Juan Mountains of Colorado in 2009, where the magnitude of the dust deposition on that snowpack is visibly quite obvious. We're talking about regional sources of dust here. These are not by and large sources that travel a very far distance. I'm sorry about the bottom image there. That seems to have been shifted somehow. But satellite observations, back trajectory models, particle size distributions, and mineralogy all point to regional sources. These are big dust sizes that we're seeing on the snowpack. particle size is well above the PM 2.5 and 10 particle sizes that are commonly measured by the improved network, et cetera. Rich, actually, in his talk, the first talk of the session, showed a satellite image of dust plumes on April 3rd, 2009. Well, here's what it looked like in Silverton, Colorado. A little bit of an apocalyptic-looking sky right ahead of the snowstorm. Really gives an idea as to exactly how much mass is being transported into the environment from these storms. Same date in the backcountry near Aspen, Colorado. Same storm. We watched a wall of red air approach and then turn the snow orange right before our eyes. Pretty dramatic. This is the next day, looking at the April 3rd layer. The laser's gone. That top layer in the snow pit. The dust came in, was deposited on the snowpack surface, followed pretty quickly by fresh snow. You can see two other layers in that snow pit face that were separated by about a week with intervening snowfalls. These were three of 12 dust layers recorded in 2009 over the entire upper Colorado basin. So these are wide-ranging events depositing quite a large amount of mass on the snowpack. Oh, thanks. As spring snowmelt commences and continues, the dust ends up on the snow surface. This is important. If the dust were to wash out with meltwater, we wouldn't have much in the way of radiative forcing. Instead, the dust collects on the snow surface and continues to darken the snow albedo throughout the season, ending up with snow surfaces that look like the picture in the background from May 2009. Dust primarily impacts the reflectivity of snow and the visible wavelengths, as shown in the spectra here. Clean snow in the visible reflects nearly 100% of the incident solar or incident visible light, which is, of course, why it looks white to our eyes. Dirty snow down around 0.5 in reflectivity, so a doubling of net solar input to the snowpack with dust. This effect extends into the near infrared, both from direct absorption and from grain size coarsening associated with extra heat input. This darkening of the snowpack surface enhances snowmelt. This is work that Mackenzie Skiles is doing at UCLA. The red lines in these graphs for 6 years are modeled snow water equivalent during the melt season as driven by energy balance observations at our field site in southwest Colorado. The black dots in there are manual observations of snow water equivalent, showing that we're doing a good job of simulating the snowmelt processes at this site. The blue lines show what happens to the snowmelt if you remove the effects of dust, and the reduced melt rates from the cleaner snowpack are quite obvious to the eye. Where they intersect, the x-axis is the meltout date. From 2005 through 2008, we see that the dust on the snowpack is melting the snowpack out about a month earlier than it would in the absence of dust. In 2009 and 2010, extremely heavy dust years, we're looking at 45 to 50 days early meltout from the effects of dust on snow. We see this throughout the range and indeed throughout the upper basin. This is data from the Beartown Snowtell automated snow water equivalent site in the Rio Grande headwaters. The gray range in the background is the historic range of snow water equivalent at this site. The black line is the long-term mean. The red line is water year 2009, so you can see that we had essentially an average snowpack, both in timing and in magnitude, but dust forced increased and enhanced snowmelt rates produced the earliest meltout date on record at this site. So obviously, if you think about this effect getting distributed over the entire upper Colorado River Basin, this is a major perturbation to the snowmelt energetics and is going to have a big impact on the hydrology. To study exactly what that impact is, or to assess that impact, we've used the Vic hydrology model with a couple different snow albedo decay curves based on observations from current dusty condition. That's the ADL red lines in the top left plot. Versus a cleaner, not completely clean, but much reduced dust impact, which is the BDL scenario in these albedo decay curves. This is work that we published last year in PNAS. Here's what using those two different decay curves does to the melt-out dates or the snow-all-gone dates basin-wide. The first reality check is looking at the grid cell that includes our field observations, and we see changes in snow melt-out date equivalent to what we've observed on the ground there. We see a complex spatial pattern influenced by elevation, by snow accumulation, and by vegetation cover. Notably, I want to draw your attention to this middle elevation band here in the Colorado Rockies that sees a slightly reduced impact in terms of melt-out date on due to dust on snow. This is the montane forest belt, which is currently experiencing a rather massive mountain pine beetle infestation epidemic, the result of which is producing dramatic changes in the forest canopy, allowing more shortwave energy in and potentially adding a lot more area to be more severely influenced by dust on snow. So some ecosystem interactions there beyond the simple radiation forcing. The effect of changing the duration of the snow cover basin-wide has an impact on the full basin hydrograph. These are modeled hydrographs for Lee's Ferry, which is the dividing point between the upper and lower Colorado basin. The red hydrograph is the current dusty conditions, matches observations well. When we clean up the snowpack, again through changing the albedo curves in the VIC model, we see that our current conditions exhibit a 3-week early peak in snowmelt, a steeper rising limb on the hydrograph, which complicates water management decision making, and 5% less annual runoff if you integrate those two curves. 5% in this overallocated system is a big deal. It's twice Las Vegas's annual allocation. It's 18 months for Los Angeles, and it's half our treaty obligation to Mexico. We see variability over the 88-year record of simulation in that change in yield or change in runoff from 2.5% to 7% of annual flow. Notably, the big reductions come in big snow years. That's a longer snow melt season over which dust on snow can work its magic. And we're losing more water during those big snow years that we count on to recharge the system storage, both in our surface water reservoirs and also in soil moisture. So we could be having a bigger impact than the 5% annual average would suggest. Now I want to note that these albedo curves are based on observations made during 2005 through 2008. I've already shown you a good bunch of pictures from 2009 and talked about what a big dust year 2009 was. Some recent work by Munson et al. Published in PNAS this year shows that dust emission is likely to increase with regional warming due to temperature impacts on plant coverage. So it may be that the dust years that we saw in 2009, 2010 represent some sort of new normal, or at least a more likely condition under future climates. Warmer temperatures also have direct impacts on snow accumulation and melt. So a natural question now is, how will these warming temperatures and increased dust emission affect Colorado River runoff? So we've extended the prior study that I've just presented by developing a new albedo curve that we refer to as EDL, or enhanced dust loading. That's the black curves in the top left here. Much steeper albedo decay and ending up with a much lower minimum albedo, around about the 0.35 that we saw in 2009. Very dark snow surfaces. We've convolved these now three dust scenarios with four different climate scenarios in a delta method approach, forcing precip, Tmax, and Tmin, the observed record of precip, Tmax, Tmin, using the average of 20 GCM grid cells centered on the upper Colorado basin. We've bookended the potential climate response with the SRES B1 and A2 emission scenarios for 2050 and for 2100. Here's the delta perturbations. Don't go too dizzy looking at all the numbers, but it's B1 on the left table, A2 on the right. And the general pattern is reduced precip in the summer months, slightly increased in the winter months. Notably, Tmin, minimum temperatures warming faster than maximum temperatures during the winter months and vice versa during the summer. So we use these numbers to perturb the existing 88-year historic driving data set that we used in the prior study. These are maps of change in snow all gone or change in melt-out date under the different scenarios, the different dust scenarios. Where's the mouse? Vertically here, and the different climate scenarios moving left to right. Everything relative to the current dust, current climate, which is the ADL historic scenario. You'll see that the cleaner BDL dust scenario, even under some moderate climate change, still produces a good number of grid cells that actually result in a longer snow season. But the overall pattern is a much shorter snow season with the climate warming. Definitely enhanced by the enhanced dust. So the more dust we have and the more climate warming we have, the shorter snow season. Here's the 2100, or sorry, excuse me, the A2 scenario. And when we get into the real extreme warmings, there's some of the summer months are looking at close to 7 degrees warming under A2 and 2100, which is kind of absurd, or at least frightening. We see a very strong signal from the warming there with it's a little more difficult to see the dust impact in the extreme warming scenarios, but it is still there. Here's the effect on the hydrograph. So the red and blue curves were the same ones we saw earlier. Now with the black curve for EDL, we see yet another 20-day shift or so in the runoff peak. A bit less in terms of impact on yield, where we saw 5% difference between ADL and BDL, between the current dust and the clean scenario, only about a 1% decrease with current climate and in the enhanced dust. We throw the effects of climate change in there. We see further reductions in yield and further advances in snow melt timing. The shaded areas there represent the area between the B1 and A2 influences. This is 2050. We move into 2100, and again, more substantial reductions. This plot shows the annual flow for the current climate, current dust in the top panel, and deviations from that in the bottom panel with the different dust and climate scenarios. The blue line here showing that 5% on average more flow in the river under the cleaner scenario, and the black line showing about that 1% average decrease under EDL. The climate change scenarios in there throw pretty dramatic reductions on the river flow, at least in this implementation. Again, I want to point out that the biggest reductions in flow, or the biggest changes due to dust and due to dust and climate, come in the biggest flow years. Again, these are years that we count on managing this over-allocated system to recharge our storage capacity, and further decreases with 2100. Flow timing retains a lot of sensitivity to dust loading in all scenarios. Again, the top panel is current dust, current climate, and this is center of mass of the hydrograph, so the point at which 50% of the annual flow has passed the gauge, and then departures from that in the lower panel. And you can see we're in the two-week later flow under BDL, two-week earlier flow than current with the black trace there showing the EDL. And that sensitivity persists with the climate change scenarios. So with B1 or 2050 climate, cleaning up the snowpack might get us back to pretty what we consider normal timing. That sensitivity remains pretty well intact even in the 2100 scenarios. So to summarize, the sensitivity to dust and climate forcings, at least for this model implementation, the plot on the right shows that change in yield for different dust scenarios going left to right on the x-axis, and the different lines are for the different climate scenarios. Reduced sensitivity for yield under, especially in the more extreme warming, it's still there, but not as much as under the current climate. Center of mass and the timing, the sensitivity appears to be fairly consistent even under extreme warming. Basically, this says two things to me. One, we really, really want to avoid an A2 2100 type of climate. Anything we can do to avoid that, I think, for this reason and others. And two, the sensitivity of the runoff and the hydrology system in the Upper Colorado to dust forcings is still present even under extreme warming. and therefore dust mitigation or dust abatement efforts could provide much-needed adaptive management capacity in this this over-allocated basin. Thanks.
Time for one question.
Yeah, the 5% change is due to increased evapotranspiration. So basically, we have a month longer snow-free season. The snow-free ground evaporates, and the trees and vegetation transpire more water than a snow-covered surface would sublimate. So.
Okay, this ends the first part of our session, and we'll meet back again here at 4 o'clock.